nobody would recognize me.
When did we approve the television?
We're just missing Cheryl Jones and Mr. Porter.
Open meeting, yeah.
So I think we'll proceed. We'll start the meeting with a roll call.
Jeremy Biggs.
Here.
Don Clark.
Here.
Marty Davis.
Here.
Margaret Hurley.
Here.
Larry Johnson.
Here.
Cheryl Jones. Don Lamoge.
Yep.
Deborah Manto here. Bob Porter. Brian Rapp.
Here.
Melissa Richmond.
Here.
Bethany York.
Here.
Thomas here.
Here. So in our continuing chair of the chairman responsibilities, I'm going to be chairing the meeting this evening. And for CCTV, this is the committee to, the search committee for the city manager. And I would like to thank Bethany for all the good work in the last little bit between meetings, organizing us, getting us set up, and setting up CCTV, getting us information. And Deb, would you like to let us know what you've given us for information?
Yes.
Which we discussed at our last meeting.
Yes. I downloaded the goals and objectives for the city council, so we would have reference for those. The draft vision statement for the master plan committee that's currently undergoing the next master plan hasn't been finalized, but it's a good draft of the vision statement, the minutes, and then also the master plan, I mean the steering committee did a citywide survey about 5 or 6 months ago, and it was 240, I think, respondents. So I pulled out the questions about two things that the people wanted to see change about Clamath. I thought those comments might be helpful for us in looking for a new city manager.
I thought we'd start the meeting also with just some basic information so we're all clear. We could get the agenda and potentially the minutes ahead on the website, the City of Clamath website for the City Manager Search Committee, right on the front page, pretty easy to find. Is everyone able to access a computer and do that? So that's a good way to be ready, and if you could, for the most part, bring those papers, that would help us all get a little more organized. We could be responsible for bringing our agendas minutes ahead so we could be looking at it. Yes?
I can't hear as well as I used to.
I know. So
I can't either.
Okay. If you want to maybe sit at that end, you might be able to hear me.
If I can see your lips, I can.
Okay. So yeah. Maybe if you sit over there, you might be able to see better.
Yeah. The hearing doctor tells me I'm reading lips.
All three of us.
Okay.
Yeah, as long as you looked at me, and then if Matty moves back, I'm fine.
All right.
You have the four elders.
And that's pretty much it for the notes from the chair. And Bethany, do you have anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, I just want to disclose that on last Wednesday, I did send a letter to the mayor and have her read it at the city council meeting. I finally got a chance to take a look at it today online, and it seemed like Victor was having a little bit of trouble with his computer and reading it and seeing it or whatever. But just to be clear about what I have done, I want to read it into the record here. Dear Mayor Lovett, thank you for bringing the concerns of the members of the screening committee to the attention of the council. My intent in asking for your assurance that the selection of the next city manager has already not been made in light of the conversations I have had with folks in town was not intended to derail or delay the selection process. Rather, it is intended to underscore the need for an open, inclusive, and transparent process that will result in the city finding the most qualified candidate for the position of city manager. And while it may seem interesting to explore the whodunit aspect as to the source of the initial remarks, I will leave it up to the councilor who spoke to express their position if and when they feel that it's necessary. Now, I served on the city manager search committee the last time Clamath hired a city manager. The search committee in 2001 was convened only after several very unpleasant and damaging starts and stops during that search process. For those who remember, the city had devolved into turmoil after the resignation of the city manager.
Claremont Fire Chief Peter Chase was appointed as an interim manager until a new manager, a gentleman by the name of Mr. Barker, was hired. Mr. Barker stayed a mere 18 days until his resignation. The fire chief again served as interim for a time until another city manager, Mr. Hodgkinson, was appointed. It was then that the city council hired or referred to New Hampshire Municipal Association to step in, involve the public to create a profile of the ideal candidate, invite a large committee to sift through over 50 applicants. The committee forwarded their picks to a smaller screening committee who then interviewed the candidates and made a final recommendation that fit the qualities, the expertise, and the proven track record the city needed. The process resulted in genuine buy-in by many Claremont stakeholders because of the outreach and the inclusion of the taxpayers in the process. Thus, Mr. Sandegate was hired, and the city began to recover its pride and start to heal. That was 15 years ago. As it stands right now, the taxpayers in the city are paying $15,000 to Municipal Resources, Inc. to assist with finding the best possible candidate from across the country. Once a city manager is hired, it will be the taxpayers who will be covering the $135,000 each year for his or her salary. Therefore, it seems reasonable to ask the city council for assurance that this process can be open, meaningful, and inclusive for the taxpayers and stakeholders in the community. The last thing our city needs is a repeat of the painful process that we endured in 2001. Thank you.
Okay, and if there, we can also settle on when we correspond with others that we can let each other know when you come as full disclosure, either conversation or written writing, one needs to say what might have happened, if you met with people, how it went on, so we can all know what's happening. That's about transparency and full disclosure. That's a good idea. Yes?
Who's the author of that letter, please?
That is me.
You are, okay,
yes.
Thank you. I'd like to have it entered into the record, please, if I could.
I have a question, Kyle.
Yes.
I always go around on this with the solicitor, but she, it seems to me, from a safety point of view, the city and even the municipal association recommend basically no discussion between members, regardless of whether it's a quorum or not. I don't know that I agree with that because the law says a quorum per se. So I would think two or three people could talk outside the meeting, but I guess the intent is to have everything within the public meeting. Is that right?
That
although you and Bethany, I know, need to communicate, you're both chairs for this.
Right, to keep organized, but sure. Yes, that's the idea. That's the idea, so that it's for more transparency, so that the public knows what we're all talking about.
So,
any other organizational pieces anyone would like to
could I,
put
in? Just
this,
I have
this
a, still a question. Now, the rumors that were brought forward on the last meeting have been dismissed now.
You know, I listened to the city councilors, and it was about what I expected. Unless I'm not going to divulge who it is. There are many members of the city council who are friends of mine. And if they tell me something in confidence, I keep that confidence. So in asking, I was really asking, are we sure we haven't made a determination? I guess that, you know, at the end of this process, if a person is hired that isn't as qualified and lives a mile down the road, we'll know it was true.
Seems like it's a lot of time wasted.
Well, I think that...
You last meeting you said the person was willing to come forward because he's very
I said angry. I would ask if the person is willing to come forward.
Yes. And you said you thought he would, or she would.
And that didn't happen, did it?
All right.
It is what it is. It's out in the public, and it's out in the public beyond what Missouri is.
mentioned. It's out, it's just out there. So that's just, again, a good reason for us to all be transparent. So moving to the adoption of the minutes, we've included the minutes in the packet. We can...
I move we accept.
Second. Pardon? Larry Johnson?
All those, go ahead.
A lot of questions about...
Sure.
I don't know if it's appropriate time or not. I've been confused today on the title of our committee, and I didn't know if we were called a screening committee or a steering committee. And it sounds like a minor point, and it may be, but do you know, does anyone know what the official name is?
Maybe the screening committee.
I looked on the website, and it said the Claremont City Manager Search Screening Committee.
Screening?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for asking. Screening. Was that any other comment? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous.
Did you get a second?
Yes. Yeah, Larry.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Go again.
And I thought this would be a good time in our first meetings to talk about how we take citizen input, if we take citizen input at all, if we take it at any point in time. For example, in a city council meeting, we have a point in time in which there's time for citizen input and there's a time limit on it, about 5 minutes. And then as items come up, if people can come and speak during those items. So those are all ideas I'm throwing out, like a discussion about how we'd like to handle public input. I guess starting with, would we like the public input?
Can I ask one thing? That if we're going to have this kind of discussion about citizen input, that we bring Mr. Gould into the discussion?
Yes, I agree.
About citizen input?
Yes.
I would think that we would be able to figure out on our own as a committee if we want citizen input from our own community. I'm not sure how that affects us.
Well, MRI is part of this.
Yes.
Well, it's always helpful since we are getting advice from them to have at least have his perspective
sure.
on this.
Absolutely. I do point out we are our own committee.
Yeah, and I think most committees in the city, regardless of what they're doing, I think they do typically have a spot in their agenda for citizens' comments or citizens' input.
That's all fine, but Mr. Gould is also part of this process, and I think that we should have, we can still be our own group, but to not take advice from people that have a lot of expertise in this area would be not right in my opinion.
Okay.
Sure.
I agree with that.
Yeah.
So I'm starting with, are we interested in having public input? Because if we're not, then that's the end of our discussion. So are we interested in having public input?
I would say yes.
I am.
Anyone opposed to public input? Okay.
Well, it depends on, with me, it would depend on when and how you did it.
Yes, so right. Now we can discuss about yeah. when and how. And
well, okay.
How
why don't I make a motion that any person from the public can speak at the beginning of the meeting for up to 5 minutes or 3 minutes. I'll make a motion they can speak up to 3 minutes.
I'll second that.
Is that
any discussion?
I think
that?
As part of the discussion, can we have Mr. Gould speak to this issue now? Because we need, if we're going to have his oversight, then this would be the time so we can make a decision.
As part of the discussion?
Yes.
Yes. Mr. Gould?
Sure. Would you like me to stand or will the microphone pick me up from here?
Be comfortable.
You can ask our CCTV person here.
Yeah,
if
you
can
stand that way, this way, that'll work.
Okay, so I think it's been pretty widely reported that we did create an email address for input regarding this process, and that has been clermontcm@mrigov.com. I've made my phone number available and my own email address. I also spent about 3 hours in this room right here just taking anybody that wanted to drop in and talk to me. And there are some people that I recognize that availed themselves of that time.
We interviewed employees of the town, of the city rather, and we've interviewed counselors. So all in all, we've probably spoken with or received input in one form or another from 40 or 45 people. So everybody that has wanted to provide us with input has done so. However, you know, input that you may take is fine. Input is never a bad thing. You represent 13 people from 13 different places, and I consider that just all more input. You know, this process is designed so that, you know, you folks from all of your different backgrounds are able to interview these candidates. First, select which candidates you want to interview, and then interview those candidates. So to me, that's a pretty fair representation of the community. And how you all, as individuals or as a committee, gain further insight to what you think is good for the city is up to this committee. The only thing I would say is that we really want to keep moving deliberately through the process because we don't want to lose candidates.
So if we were to have public, so there's a motion on the floor for allowing public input at the beginning of the meeting for up to 3 minutes.
We
have discussion on that. Yes.
Before we vote.
Yes.
Based on what Mr. Gould said, I would say that we should not have any public input for his explanation that we have 13 people to represent us. And I don't think it's going to be helpful to have one or two other people come in who represent only themselves to add more information to us. I think as you said earlier, we're committing, when I kind of paraphrasing what you said, but I think we're capable of making our decisions and developing our own information.
Okay, so that's one input, one opinion. Yes.
I'm sorry, I'm really shocked to hear that. I think the number of people who would come to the meeting may be minimal if there's a group that decides they want to show up and comment on what they see for our business. I think it's appropriate that we allow that. To deny comment to the public, it's counter to everything that I've seen and that I do, whether it's on the school board or anything else that I've done. Public comments are I think, imperative with what we're doing and with any board or committee in the city. Whether people decide to act on that is up to the public, but I think it's really important that we avail a couple minutes before our meeting, before our business, to hear what some people have to say. And I would be really, if I were sitting at home and I heard people saying that they don't really want to have public input, I'd probably be screaming down to yell at everybody because it's something we really should make sure we do.
Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I see your hands. Go ahead.
We both have our hands up.
Right down the line.
Okay. I can respect Brian. That's right. Point of view here. I understand. Public input is very fine. At the same time, if it's 2 or 3 minutes, I have no problem with that. But if you have a lot of people coming in, it tends to be out half an hour to an hour. Now, our time is limited. Our time is short. We are meeting late as it is. We want to get this job done before the end of the year. We have November to do it. And it's going to require a lot of time, a lot of meetings to get the job done. I'll be a little concerned about having a lot of public input here so that we have less time to work among ourselves with these candidates and with the resumes and with Mr. Gould to get the job done. I want to see us move forward as expeditiously as possible without too much delay in this area.
I wonder if I could offer kind of a compromise here. I think that once that we get into the nuts and bolts of reviewing resumes and interviewing folks, that that's a place where public comment is not appropriate. So if we could just say that at the beginning of our next meeting, any people that wanted to come in and make public comment would be welcome, and we'd make note of that comment.
I could live with that.
And then after that, we get down to business. And subsequent meetings, you know, when we're involved in the nitty gritty of the process, we shouldn't be taking public comment because the public doesn't know, shouldn't be knowing what we're doing.
Right. Those meetings would be not public. So.
questions.
Yes.
Yeah. You know, it's a public meeting, and I don't think we could prevent people from coming in. However, everybody had a chance to be on this committee. In fact, the council went overboard. They were only wanted 9. We have, I don't know, 13 now. So this is supposed to be the cross-section of the community. And this is our job to decide what we're going to do with the city manager, what the citizens want. And if they want to come in, I don't have a problem. If they want to, I don't know what they're going to say. Yeah, but for 3 minutes is fine. But I don't think that we should open this up for a big deal over it.
If I could just say one thing, it's not necessarily necessary to have them visit the meeting as well. I mean, we could provide them with, you know, a point of contact to say, please feed your input into this email address or whatever it is. That can be distributed to us, mm-hmm. and then we can take that into consideration when we're having our meeting, but we don't need to dedicate public time to it. I haven't been on many of these meetings, so I'm not sure exactly if that's the right way to go about things, but it would allow our meeting time to actually be very, more focused on what we need to accomplish, because he's right, I mean, we do have a limited amount of time to deal with this work.
Yes.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, we already, don't we have a website that people can give their comments to and run it simultaneously. Just keep promoting whatever contact website it is. People can comment all they want.
Right.
It can be gathered electronically while we're doing our work, and then we can just print off the comments.
So I will say that after 8 years of being on the city council, and maybe Brian, because we've sat on public boards for so long, I just can't imagine a public meeting in which you don't have a segment available for public comment. And that's one of the ways to keep it from turning into a big hullabaloo is to have a time limit on when one can say, so people are organized and make their statement. I'm going to doubt that we're going to have 50 people show up and make a comment. But I think just as a policy from a transparent committee, I'm pretty strong on allowing a public comment time at the beginning of the meeting as was proposed. And that's my comment. Yes.
I'm wondering if we're not mixing up two things. When we have a public meeting, allowing the public to speak briefly at the beginning of the meeting is not asking them for what they want in a candidate. It's not, that is, I wasn't seeing that as what we were trying to do here. This would just be a housekeeping thing where if somebody shows up at the beginning of the meeting, Bernie Volta is usually here. He usually has something on his mind. He either has observed something, wants to share something. And I think that we're talking about two different things. I wasn't suggesting that Mr. Gould would be trying to quickly take down notes and alter his profile or whatever they've come up with based on somebody that shows up at the meeting. I think that's a completely different thing.
Well, I understand that the non-public is totally excluded.
Yes.
Public's excluded.
And do I have the committee's permission to have one public make a comment? Mm-hmm. Is that okay?
Debbie, can Debbie say what she wants to say?
I just want to say that I'm in favor of allowing the public to speak. At least I believe that transparency and getting as much comment as we can from the public, regardless of what it is crucial. And we're hiring somebody that could, you know, move our city in the next 10 years. So to at all say, we don't want to hear what you have to say at any point during this process, to me is not going to help us get people to buy into whoever ends up being a candidate. And I think that's crucial. So if we have to spend a little more time to listen to a few more people, I think that it's important. I don't see what we gain by saying no, honestly. And it's done pretty much across the board with every committee in the city, and I don't see why we should be different.
Mr. Folt.
Thank you, Madam Co-Chair. Bernie Folt, Ward 3. I think Bethany Urich, as far as I'm concerned, hit the nail on the head. You may be talking about two different things, because when you get the materials for the candidates, the meetings are going to be closed, except there'll be a brief portion, open portion, during which you will move to go into closed session, and then a brief portion at the end to come out. And so it's true, somebody could come at the very beginning to make a comment about the input they want to get about the content of your material, but it might be someone who wants to say something about process or housekeeping, as I often do, because I'm a process guy. So, I think just allowing some time with limitations is a very contemporary and a very good idea. Now, if I may extend, in terms of process, one of the things I've already seen that bothers me is, it has to do with Robert's Rules. Now, I guess you haven't adopted Robert's Rules, but the council has, with some exceptions. And I think that sort of splashes on groups that the council appoints or authorizes. And one of those is the motion called Move the Question. Move the Question is a very, very special and dangerous motion because it shuts off debate more or less instantaneously. And that's why Robert's Rules requires a two-thirds votes to move the question. Except, if you read Robert's Rules, a motion to table something can be made while after somebody makes a move the question. So when somebody says move the question, first of all, don't say it idly, because that really needs to be taken seriously. It shuts off debate and causes, presumably, the chair, if following Robert's Rules, to ask for a two-thirds vote to shut off debate. And that could happen in your non-public session, too, not just in open session. So I just caution you about that. That's a frequent thing. And Robert's Rules does try to indicate that more discussion among intelligent and basically rational people in order to come to good decisions is a generally good thing. Thank you.
Okay, we have a motion on the table. And can you read the motion back?
Motion by Bethany Urich, seconded by Debbie Mansfield, to allow people from the public to speak for up to 3 minutes at the beginning
of each of the meetings. Yeah. I'll try a voice vote first so that we can see the consensus. All those in favor? I'm sorry.
If I could.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure that we understand what we're voting on. This is 3 minutes at the beginning of our business meeting.
A person to be able to come in and say, I don't like what you're doing, I like what you're doing. I'll tell you, if we were to say only at the next meeting you get 3 minutes, I guarantee I would be there cussing you out for saying that you don't want to have a little bit of public input. We do it at all of our meetings. It's a small amount of time. It's inviting the public to give a couple comments, what their thoughts are. To shut off public comment is a smack to the face of the community. And I'll just leave that out there.
I don't believe that. I just want to go on record as saying that. You know, slap in the face is pretty serious.
It is.
Yeah.
So public comment is also serious.
This is a public meeting. If people want to come in and we give them 3 minutes, I don't understand why that's a problem.
Right. That's what we're saying.
I'm saying it. That's what I want.
Well,
I want the 3 minutes.
And if you rephrase it.
So the question comes down, and maybe the motion ought to be clarified, whether you want that to happen at any meeting or at particular meetings. I mean, we have this process, the 91A, allows us to go into private.
We have to.
We have to. This is not the same as a city council meeting. This is something that involves people and their reputations, and we're going to be privy to information on these folks that we should not be disclosing.
If I could.
Excuse me. So I think we're mixing apples with oranges again.
Well, I think we would...
So at the beginning of each meeting, there'll be a public part of the meeting, and then in any meeting in which we're talking about candidates, we will go into non-public, and that will remain non-public, and no one will talk about that out of public. So there's no reason for any public comment about that.
We have to start the meeting in public session.
But we always start in public session. So at the beginning of that meeting, if someone wanted to say something for a few minutes about anything that we're up to, that's when they would do it, and then we would go into non-public. And you are correct, we would never talk about, it's not about the choice of candidates or all that.
You know, what I'm afraid of is that people would come in at the beginning of some meeting when we're halfway through the process with some rumor, you know, and that could be damaging to the process.
This is a free country. People get to say what they'd like to say. Yes, Mr. Porter, you could just come in on this, so
yeah,
you have a chance to comment.
I apologize for being on time, but could you just, someone repeat the motion for me so I'm up to speed a little bit?
Motion was made by Bethany Urich, seconded by Debbie Matto, to allow the public to speak for up to 3 minutes at the beginning of the meeting.
Of every meeting?
Of every meeting.
Thank you.
And by public, we mean one, each person has 3 minutes, is that correct?
Yeah.
Up to 3 minutes, right.
Now, how I'm envisioning it would be, we'd come in, we'd have our roll call, we'd have notes, we'd adopt our minutes, we'd have public comment, and then we'd get on to...
Whatever the business is.
Whatever the business is. We have discussion, or if we're going to go in to non-public to deal with
personnel.
And then it's just that brief bit of time at the beginning.
I don't want to be, this is picky. 3 minutes is a lot of time. I mean, I was a radio commentator for years, and I could say a hell of a lot in 3 minutes. So I'm thinking maybe we could limit the time a little bit in terms of each person and the amount of time he or she has to speak. I don't know. I mean, anyway.
I'd like to reverse my previous thought, and I'm in favor of the motion. I don't think we're going to be overwhelmed with people. We're going to find out tonight what the process is, but I don't think we're going to have that many meetings that are open to the public. I don't know, but I can't imagine we're going to be doing a lot of procedural meetings. I think 95% of our time will be in non-public meetings, so I don't see it as a huge issue, and I'm in favor of the motion.
Okay, so we can try.
Can I do a roll call?
Yeah, okay, let's do a roll call. So we're
Jeremy Biggs?
Aye.
Don Clark?
Aye.
Marty Davis?
Aye.
Robert Hurley?
Aye.
Larry Johnson?
Abstain.
Abstain?
Mm-hmm. Based on what?
Based on what purpose?
You have to have a reason.
You have to have a reason to abstain.
I have to have a reason to abstain?
Yes.
Okay, is that Robert's rules, by the way? Bernie?
Well, the city council has a rule in their council rules like that.
Okay.
And don't wait, know about Robert's rules.
I'll vote for it then.
Don LaMoche?
Yes.
Deborah Mantel, yes. Robert Porter?
Yes.
Brian Rapp?
Yes.
Melissa Richmond?
Yes.
Bethany Urich?
Yes.
Tom Messier?
Yes. Okay.
Perfect.
Mr. Gould, MRI presentation. You provide an overview of the process conducting the search screening.
So we've been sending updates at each phase of the process. I think I sent the last one just about a week or so ago. So I'll just provide a little bit of an overview about that. We have 37 candidates from 18 states and one from United Kingdom. There were 6 candidates from Vermont and New Hampshire. There were 5 from Virginia, 4 from Florida, 3 from Massachusetts, and 1 each from Idaho, Georgia, New Jersey, Texas, West Virginia, Wisconsin, Washington, Connecticut, New York, Oregon, Arizona, and Illinois. Of those candidates, 2 had juris doctor and master's degrees, 3 hold a Juris Doctor and bachelor's degree, 27 have master's degrees, and 5 candidates have bachelor's degrees. So we ranked a team of two of us at MRI ranked those resumes, and then we sent out essay questions, which were developed based on the input we had received from everybody to date. And we thought that they'd be helpful to all of us in further selecting the candidates. So we sent out essays to 16 candidates. At that point, we had, since that time, we've had 2 withdrawals, and we cut 2 from the process as non-responsive. So they didn't return essays, and they told us they were gone when they didn't make a deadline. So that left us with 12 folks, which is a pretty good number. We have the 12th phone interview tomorrow, so we've been doing phone interviews since last Thursday or Friday, and those will finish up tomorrow with 1 last interview that was scheduled. And I would have, by noontime tomorrow, I would have the opportunity to get the submittals to you all electronically. Those submittals would be the cover letter, the essay answers. I think you already have the essay questions. I think you have the ideal candidate profile. So we would get you the cover letter, the essays, and whatever material they might have attached to those resumes. So we just call those the submittals. So we would send those to you folks for review, and then we should set up a meeting for, you know, it can be as early as mid next week, or whatever time frame you're comfortable with, to review those essays. I would ask you that you would kind of rank the candidates. So if we have 12 candidates, kind of rank those candidates 1 through 12, so that, you know, we can come in and the question is basically going to be, you know, what 6 do you want to interview? And an easy way to achieve that is to say how many have Mr. Smith in their top 6, and we just kind of go through the group and do a tally like that. If I know something about the candidates at that point that would be helpful to you in making that decision, we would certainly let you know that. So you're going to have to pick a date for that meeting, when I would come up and meet with you and help you go through those submittals and determine which 6 you want to invite. Then we have to set a date for the on-site interviews, and that would be the interview that you folks would be having. And there'd be 2 interviews going on at the same time, so you folks would be interviewing a candidate while our MRI panel of 3 management consultants is interviewing a different candidate in the next room. And then we flip. We would do that for the day. At the end of the day, we come together and figure out who's going to move forward to the city council. So that's pretty much what the process looks like.
How many will go finally to the council?
We like to see 3 generally. Again, you know, the 12 submittals that you will get tomorrow, you shouldn't think that all of these are the best fit. So this gives you an opportunity to kind of see what the best of the group looked like, or the most likely fits, and it gives you some basis for comparison. So, you know, I don't want you to think that all 12 of those we're recommending to the position. It's that these are the 12 out of the 37 that have risen to the top through the process.
Would it be fair to say that you're rating them according to their qualifications, and it's our job to try to figure out who the best fit would be?
I think that's a really good way to look at it. Every community kind of desires something a little different. I have some amount of input. I've done a lot of research. I've spent quite a bit of time in the community. So, you know, we take kind of a best guess, and I've done dozens of these. I do dozens of them a year in every New England state. So we get a pretty good sense of what might work in a community. So, and we also try to screen out those folks, or we've already screened out those folks that have what I would consider enough baggage that we would eliminate them from the process. There are just certain things we look for in doing this because we do so much of it. So we've already eliminated those people. So that's not to say that everybody that you're gonna see is crystal clean. But it's a matter of, you know, sometimes somebody has some things you really, really need, some things you really desire, and you may be able to overlook something in their background or in you know, something that we find out that isn't particularly a problem for you folks. Yes, sir.
Just a process question. So the 12 that you'll send us will be by email. They'll be, I'm assuming, confidential?
Yes.
We all need to be aware that this is confidential.
Very important, because many of these people are still employed. And, you know, if they get invited to an interview with the city council, then at that point, that's when they would usually let their employer know that they're in this process. But they really don't want to jeopardize their own good standing in a community until they really need to. That's pretty important. And I know that when you get the submittals, everybody's going to have maybe a desire to pick up the phone and call somebody they know, or call somebody in a community where these folks are coming from. And I'm just asking, you have to be really careful about that, because as soon as that goes out there, it can become a problem. And we have, I think that we get some fine candidates. A lot of people know MRI for the integrity that we have in these processes, and I really don't want to see anything to damage that either. So,
to follow up on that, should we discuss this as a group and maybe have decide on a procedure that no one does? I mean, our responsibility is to read and think about these things, that no one reaches outside, as you're suggesting, for references. It doesn't seem appropriate for what we're supposed to do, but we might consider making that clear, if that's the way we all feel about it. And I have a couple other questions. And both you and Bethany, you mentioned in that letter that you sent to the council, I think you referred to a salary of $135,000, and I'm thinking that it was a quote package or not. Was the limit set as a salary plus benefits, or?
You know, I don't have that in front of me, so I wouldn't dare say. It seems like it was a full package, but
okay.
I'm not sure. I mean, I think that we're not, I don't even know if our city manager now has reached $100,000, but.
Well, with benefits, $150,000.
But maybe you know what we're offering.
There was considerable discussion with the city council about that very issue. And what we came up with and what advertised is a compensation range to $135,000.
Total compensation.
So, no, I wouldn't say that that's total compensation. So I think that there can be a mix. And I think it's going to come down to the final candidate. You have, if you heard that discussion that we had with the city council, your city manager is compensated a little differently. There's a salary, and then there's this other, I think it's a retirement amount that's fairly significant. So it's kind of those things together, and like the council was very careful about where we set that range. And we want to make sure that when we advertise this, we don't want to be offering a salary of $105,000, but say that it's $135,000, because you could pick the best candidate, and then we can't make the deal. So it's very important that we set a realistic expectation on both sides. And in this case, the ad says salary range to compensation range up to $135,000. And as I'll tell candidates, it's all money. So whether you call it, whether there's some vehicle expense in there, whether there's a retirement, extra retirement stipend, whatever it is, it's all money. So it's a matter of what that final package looks like.
So it may be $135,000, it could be more, depending on what you negotiate,
what the city negotiates, yes. And that's how, you know, that really depends on how desirable the candidate is. We're in a time right now where there's kind of a void of experienced management level people. A lot of folks my age and a little older are retiring out. And then it seems like there's a 10, 12, 15 year gap behind us where people just weren't going into public management. So now you've got some people in their mid-30s, you know, mid to high 30s, that have been in the number two positions or in subordinate positions, and they're poised to take a number one position. So they pose a little more risk to the community because they've never proven themselves in the number one position. Those can be some real stars, though. So you might offer lower compensation to somebody that's not proven because there's a little more risk involved.
And are there, I thought I heard at some point there are several communities in New Hampshire that are looking for city managers at this time. Is that the case?
Yes, this is the only one we're doing in New Hampshire right now.
Right,
but it's a pretty, I mean, it's really a national, it's a national search. And most of the communities of your size would be doing a national search. So when we talk to these folks, we find out whether they're in other processes. We try to find out where they are in those other processes. Because we want you to get the best candidates, and we don't want to lose them to another process someplace.
But there are several communities around in New Hampshire that are looking for a city manager right now.
Yes, absolutely.
I think there's like three or four.
Actually, we just got the contract to do Jaffrey, so we'll be starting that. So you're
Lebanon. There's like five.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, Newport.
Just so we all know.
Yeah. It's a very, very competitive process, and that's why we like to stay kind of deliberate through the process.
You differentiate very much between a town manager and a city manager?
When we do the reviews, when we're screening the candidates, there's some value in that they've worked in a mayor, city manager, city council form of government, but it's not huge. We find these people very adaptable, and to make the switch from town administrator to town manager to city manager, it's really more about how to communicate with people, knowing how to find the right resources, knowing about governance in general, being able to manage budgets. So to us, that's not a huge differentiation. It's really about leadership and about management and communication.
Thank you.
Yes.
I have two procedurals. The packets we're getting tomorrow, are you providing any guidelines as to how we should go about thinking about this, or do we just kind of read through them and rank them according to our gut feeling? Or?
I like you to have kind of an unbiased first look at these things. And we try not to shade it at all with anything else. I'll just tell you that there's nothing we know about any of the 12 candidates that would make them, the term I use is unhirable. Okay, I won't put anybody unhirable in front of them. But there's some that are better than others. So I like you to look at them unbiased and, you may Google the names. We've already done that stuff. We've already reached out to our network of people that are connected to us to say, what do you know about this person? What do you know about that person? So we're pretty confident that there's nobody that's in that group that's unhirable. So I would ask you to take a good, fair, unbiased look at these folks, and then just kind of figure out where you would put them, how you would rank them. And when I come in and meet with you next, we may have some more information from you, because we don't just stop by when we send those things to you folks. We kind of keep going, trying to dig stuff up and find out more about the candidates. So when I come in, we'll be able to help you even further. If there's questions about individual candidates, we'll be able to kind of fill in some of those blanks. Yes.
Could you speak to the process that you used and what you actually came up with in terms of what we're looking for? We're screening for something, and I think that there should be some consensus of what we're looking for. Are we looking for someone who has incredible economic development experience, someone who can speak to what a lot of our documents here show are high taxes and how to grapple with that, or down to, because all of us, just using our gut, may have something different that we like. In finding what is going to fit this community, not necessarily what I like personally, but what we hear in the community that is needed, necessary, desirable. Do you help us to arrive at that? Is there some way? I know New Hampshire Municipal did that with us. We sat down and we talked about, okay, what do we hear? What do we know? What are the issues that we face? And for this person to be successful in Claremont. Claremont's not an easy city. There's not a lot of money. Money covers up a lot of sins and a lot of problems. That's not something that we have here. And we could look at a candidate and say, that's a really good candidate, but they might not be a good fit for us. So what can you provide in the way of guidance so that we can make a really, really good and successful choice?
So part of the value of having this panel of 13, which is huge, I've never worked with a panel of 13 before, although I think City of Portland, we had a few more people maybe. But part of the value is that there's 13 different voices here, all coming from a different place. What you may be looking for may be different than what somebody else is looking for at the table, and that all matters, and it all matters equally. So if you look at the ideal candidate profile and challenge statement that we did, I think that you all have that. That's where we kind of put together the input that we had received from documents we had read, individual interviews, and our own knowledge. So that's where, that's what we've heard that you really kind of need. So when we do our screening of the candidates, that's what we're looking at, because that document expresses not only those qualities that you seek, that we think you're seeking, mm-hmm. Some, based on our experiences, the qualities that we think you should be seeking, and then those challenges are represented in the challenge statement, and that discuss economic development. And then further, you get the essay questions. Those essay questions are also based on what we heard when we listened, and what we know about running a city like this. So if you take the ideal candidate profile and challenge statement, that's information to help guide you. And then if you look at the essay questions, those are targeted specifically for the city of Claremont. So we ask those questions for a reason, to help us, to help give us insight, but also to give you folks insight into their thoughts on these things that we understand to be important to the city. And then you're going to have the further opportunity to interview them personally and gather even more information. So at that point, all 13 of you are fine-tuning the filter, if you will. And then it's at the end of that day, and you know, I'll bring my panel together, and my panel that day is really looking at professional credentials, even harder. And we'll ask the real hard questions, you know, at that point. So at the end of the day, we're able to come together and share information and reach consensus on who would go forward. I think I can say that in the almost 9 years that I've been doing this, I don't think I've seen a group or a process end in a mistake. And that's because, you know, we're very careful.
You weren't here.
Well, I know. I see a piece of wood I can knock on. So it's just very important. But there's a reason we do what we do, and you know, I trust all the individual voices in this room that they're gonna come together and we'll reach consensus on the right candidates. And that's a matter of getting them to the table. And at the end of the day, though, it's the city council that's responsible for making that decision. And if they make a bad decision, there's consequences for them.
A moment ago, you reeled off a number of academic credentials that some of these people have. What do you think is likely to be the most valuable credential for this particular position that we're looking at? Academic credential.
I don't know that there's an academic credential that's that trumps leadership. I think leadership is really important. For an academic credential, I mean, I've seen some people that are just fantastic managers and leaders that have, I suppose typically not even a college degree. So a PhD is not necessarily indicative of somebody that is a great leader or manager or has experience in economic development. So it's kind of the whole thing going together. The best thing for me, what I rely on heavily is what's their past performance? What's their experience been? How stable have they been? What have they done in those other communities? And the essay, you'll see in their essay responses, we give them the opportunity to tell you that. The cover letter gives them an opportunity to tell you what they think you should know. And then you hone down on that even more when you do your interviews. I'm not a huge, I don't rely heavily on academic credentials. So I always like to see whenever I craft an ad, unless it's specified by a town or city charter or ordinance, I like to leave wiggle room in there so that even somebody without a degree, if they've got all of this great experience and have had great success, they should be viewed as equally as somebody that has, you know, a JD with no experience.
Thank you.
She had her hand up first, so I just wanted to get my hand in the queue.
Do any of the candidates, have they published anything that we could read that you've discovered?
Some of them will have a list, well, many of them will have a section at the end of the resume, the CV, where, you know, they'll tell you what they've published. Typically, there's not, there'd be articles for, periodicals for, right. You know, trade journals and whatnot. we haven't relied heavily on those because there's no guarantee that they are 100% the author of those documents. Whereas, you know, that's why when we do the essays, we can't guarantee that the person wrote the essays.
We know about college essays.
So that's part of the reason we do the phone interviews. So we're able to figure out whether they really did do that. And I'm always shocked. I mean, you know, we're in a business, MRI is in a business, where we do a lot of studies and organizational studies, and we do a lot of writing. And I'm always surprised. I'll bring somebody on a project team, and I'll ask for, very often before we hire somebody, I'll ask for some kind of a writing example, you know. And I'll get it, and I'll, oh, that looks really good. And then I'll give them the first assignment, and I'll get this thing back. And if I had a red crayon, it would be, you know, it would be a lot of red. And that's because they probably had a lot of help writing it. So I'm really sensitive to that. And I think you'll be able to figure that out when you see the materials and then talk to them.
Is there any kind of fact-checking that is done kind of in tandem with, because we're going to get these essays and, you know, they're going to be providing information about what they've done, numbers that they've hit, and, you know, that kind of thing. We're not really going to have a way of knowing whether they're telling the truth or not. Is that something that you guys do, or?
It's virtually impossible, because to do that, we'd have to call around. Mm-hmm. So we really do rely a lot on, like internet checks, because these are all very public people. So, you know, we'll Google the names, we'll run them a bunch of different ways. If it's somebody that's within the region that one of the people on the team might have a, you know, connection, might be able to find something out about that person very discreetly, then we do that. We've never been burned. When the city council makes a final selection, we do a very comprehensive background investigation, and we've never done a process where that final candidate was selected, I can only think of one, it was for a fire chief, didn't pass the background. So we're pretty confident by the time that they get to that point that there's nothing there that's gonna surprise anybody.
Okay.
If your folks are surprised, then I'd be the first one to say that we didn't do our job.
You probably discussed this tonight, but I'm still a little unclear on the schedule of events. I know we're meeting tonight, and I know that we'll be in non-public when we're interviewing. And what standard meetings are we going to have between then and now?
As far as I'm concerned, all we need is a meeting as early as next week determine which candidates you want to move forward. Mm-hmm. We would then give them, immediately we send them a save the date. And then, you know, I'd like to pick a date as soon as possible. I mean, set the date as soon as possible for your on-site interviews. I figure that, you know, that should probably be about the second week of November. We get into the third week, we're getting into Thanksgiving. So that second week of November, and that gives people about 10 days to make travel arrangements. There may be some people traveling that would have to travel a great distance. I'm not sure at this point that the city wants to offset those costs at all. So we may have to make provisions for a Skype or a phone interview. If that's all right with you folks as well, we can set that up. So that, you know, there you have it. We are ready to go late next week. If that gives you, you know, a week to review the, in a weekend to review the submittals. And then we'd be ready to go probably the week after that to do those interviews. So I'm talking about, you know, a meeting with you folks the 26th or the 27th of October. And then interviews maybe something like the 14th, 15th, 17th, and 18th of November. You know, that's determined by your folks. I'm just telling you that's when we'll be ready to go.
The meeting we tentatively have next week, we will have read off everything. And will you be part of that meeting?
Yes.
Okay. So you will kind of lead that meeting?
I'd like to think I would be able to facilitate the consensus. It's your meeting. I'm here as a resource to you folks. And you know, at the end of that night, I'm able to walk out of here with the names of five or six candidates, mm-hmm. and we'd notify them the next day that, you know, we're inviting you to an interview on this date.
And so typically, the committee decides its own process to eliminate, I mean, would obviously have input about different, our views on different candidates, but how do we determine a fewer number of them?
I have found that the best way to do it is if everybody just kind of ranks the candidates, and then we just kind of say, okay, who has missed the Smith in their top six? If nobody has missed the Smith in their top six, we don't need to waste any time. I'll give you an example, though. I was doing one in a community in Mass, larger than this one, sent out the packages, just like we're talking about, and it was the same thing. I went, and everybody had ranked folks, and one of the names I threw out was a gentleman that nobody had any interest in. So we went through the whole list, and I let them all go through it. And at the end, I said, I think you're making a really big mistake. And one of the things I told your city council was, I'm going to do my best to make sure that you don't make a mistake. So this one particular person was a colonel in the Air Force. He was in charge of the base in Mashpee, Mass, Otis Air Force Base. And I said, I don't think you're giving him credit. And somebody referred to him as a flyboy. And I said, well, I think you're making a really big mistake. And if you say five, I'm going to add him as the sixth. And so I convinced them to take him. So we did the, he was then invited to the interviews with everybody else. And guess who came out of those interviews number one? He did. He accepted the job. And I think he just completed his third or fourth year in that community. He's been really successful. So that's just an example of kind of where I was able to help bring some insight to the group based on my experience doing this, that I think was helpful. And I don't think that community made a mistake at all. I think they considered that a success. And you know, my experience isn't only in doing these recruitments, it's in actually doing the job. I've been a town administrator in three communities and manage our people that serve as interim managers in communities. So, and we tend to be like kind of 911 for cities and towns. So we get involved in a lot of things in a lot of different places. So I try to use that, my own experience in that regard, to help you folks not make a mistake. Yes, sir.
About our next meeting, if we do our job thoroughly, I could see that meeting lasting a long time. It'd be a fairly lengthy meeting. You know, we got a lot of people to talk about, and the winnowing, that's the most, that meeting, and you've got the most resumes, applications in front of you, and we've got to take some time on each one of them. So my question becomes, you know, at my age, and I think there are a few others at the table the same way, it's once it gets beyond 9 or 10 o'clock at night, we fade pretty quickly. So I'm just wondering if we might think about a different starting time.
That's
certainly. I know that's up to us.
I'll bring a sleeping bag.
Okay.
And I would only tell you that it may not be as difficult as you think. There are probably in half the recruitments we do, the town or the city council says, you bring us the three top candidates. Because they don't want, I've been in a town in Mass, a little bigger than this one, and I wanted to go through the whole thing with interviewing the selectmen and whatnot, and I was told, we don't want you to interview us, we don't want to have any involvement in this, you bring us the three best candidates. That was probably 5 or 6 years ago. The manager is still there, and I think they gave him like a 25% pay increase over the time in order to retain him, because he's just really good. So I know that out of the 12, that there are some that you're going to say, oh, no way. Forget that. Yeah, exactly. So you know, you may end up really kind of debating 9 or 10, but it may be easier than you think. Certainly the earlier you meet so that you have more time at the end, that's never a bad thing. And we all get kind of grumpy and tired and don't think all that well when it gets later. So that would be certainly up to you folks, but it might not be as hard as it might seem to be. And I'll try to make it as easy as I can.
I have one more. The process of the day that we do the interviews.
Yes.
So we're interviewing and MRI's interviewing, and we get together at the end. So what happens at that meeting when we get to together. Does MRI have the same vote that we do, or do we have the only votes in deciding who's going to go onto the council? Or?
I've never seen us not reach consensus. I just like to refer to it as consensus, okay. Meaning that you'll accept input from us. But you have to remember that this is a guaranteed process. So if this doesn't work, and if the person that you hire leaves within a year, we do it again, you know, at no cost, other than the advertising. So we do have a stake in this being done correctly. So I've never dealt with a, you know, some cities we work in have an actual chartered search or selection committee, where by law, it's that group makes the selection and passes those forward. That's not the case here. So we'd like to think that we could work in conjunction, reach consensus. I view us as a resource to you folks that day. And really what I want to make sure is that typically there's maybe one or two candidates that are head and shoulders or certainly the ones we want to make sure, because we think that there might be the right people. So we want to make sure they get in there. And we'll make sure that you know if we think you're making a mistake, and we would just kind of tell you, well, you know, we think you really ought to consider this. And we've never not reached consensus. Again.
We'll try not to be an exception.
And how long do those meetings typically last? Is this
after the interviews?
No, when we're narrowing down, we're ranking 1 to 12.
Within an hour and a half, 2 hours, typically. It's usually really quick if we do it the way I'm saying, like who's interested in this person, and if one person's interested in them, certainly we can hear that person out. But if nobody else kind of has much interest, there's not a lot of time to waste on that particular candidate.
We have to do our homework and come to the meeting with the rankings done.
That's what I would say. Just kind of rank them. That's how we do it.
Can you just give us a quick idea of how, I mean, those questions are pretty substantial. How many pages are we talking per candidate?
We allow up to 2 pages per answer.
Okay.
I want to say 1.5. We tell them how it's supposed to be spaced,
yeah.
And all that stuff. Not everybody abides by that. So, I mean, I read every one of them for all the candidates that submit. So you're probably talking about a couple of hours. You know, I would say tops for that. So 12 candidates could be in the order of 80 to 100 pages, I'd say.
Okay.
And we'll have these tomorrow?
Yes. Yes, sir.
There's one thing that I'm very sensitive about. And if any of us on this committee hears out in the public the name of any of the applicants, somebody's talking out of school, and that's going to be concerning.
And that concerns,
so I think we need to police each other. You know.
And that concerns me. And if somebody asked me right now, is so and so in the process? I wouldn't say yes. I wouldn't say no.
Yeah.
Because to say no gives, you know, if you ask me if another person is, and I don't say no, then that means they must be.
Yeah.
So I'm just really careful about that stuff, and I would urge all of you folks to be just as careful. It just isn't fair. To the candidates, or fair to the process.
Well, the names shouldn't be known to the public until what point? When they go to the council, or?
Well, the whole process, RSA 901A allows the council to do their interviews in non-public as well, because it's hiring.
I see.
So that would be a council decision. In Mass, the council interviews have to be in public.
So it's probably, so the public probably won't know until the decision is made the person who's selected is made known.
Correct, and that's when we tell, when it goes to that final three, that's when we tell the candidates, you better let your bosses know.
Yeah,
okay. And even at that point, we're not at liberty to talk about any of the other candidates.
No, absolutely not.
So I guess I'm confused. Usually the final three are made public.
That's a decision that that the city makes. It's not a requirement by law. Hiring is exempt.
But right, except when there's not an expectation of privacy. And at that point,
usually, like I said, we did it with the superintendent search, and we've seen it elsewhere. Usually, when it gets down to the small number of candidates, then they're public.
It's a council decision. It's not a requirement of the law. It's a subject of a non-public. Those interviews can be a non-public interview.
There would really be nothing to be gained, if I can see, to making it public. And the two who aren't selected,
it's
still not wanting to have their bosses know about it. So.
It could be, like I said, in Mass, they must be in public. In New Hampshire, probably runs 50-50. Oh, I'm sorry.
What if one of us knows one of the candidates or the candidate's family? Do we recuse ourselves from the process?
I think if you make that known at the meeting, then I mean, that's up to the committee, but typically they would just make that disclosure, and then people can put whatever value into the comments. I would say that if that's the case, that you might be reserved in your comments and let, you know, hear everybody else so that your comments aren't going to sway what anybody else is going to say. But I think it's just important that you disclose that.
We have had city managers that came in for an interview and walked downtown and introduced themselves to store people and let them know that he was running for city manager. And that turned out to be one of the best city managers we ever had.
And that's not all that unusual. Whether it's police chief, fire chief, we may see that. Some do, some don't. Sometimes it depends on whether they're employed or whether they're not employed at the time. Sometimes people will let their bosses know when they enter a process that they're a candidate in a process. And the board or the council may understand that this is a step up for the person, or that they're looking for growth or looking to get back into a particular region. So it really goes individual by
individual.
Yeah, that I've seen that happen. So that's very true. But we don't want to make that decision for the candidate. That's up to them to make. Anybody else?
Mr. Fulton just made a comment to me. When we did our superintendent search, when we got down to the final three candidates, there was a public forum with those candidates that were allowed to interact with the public. Do you know if anything like that is planned for the council?
It hasn't been discussed. I'll tell you, a superintendent search is typically very different than a public manager search. Very different. We do very few superintendent searches. The process is tends to be totally different.
Now, and I believe last time we did a city manager search, there was a forum where there was a public input allowed. Is that unusual for that? Is that something, I'd hate to think that we're really stifling or suffocating, you know, our search. I'd like to be able to get some extra feedback. I know you said that you had some comments, but that's all very private, and you know, that's with you. When things are done in public, they tend to be a little bit different. There's a little bit different weight to them, and I would prefer to have, at some point, even if it's next week, if we put off a decision on when we were going to whittle down our candidates, I'd like to have the opportunity, and I don't know how anyone else feels, but I'd like to have the opportunity to have some sort of public input, some sort of forum where the public's allowed and everybody gets to be there and really just gives us, you know, sort of something along the lines of, you know, the comments we have with the master plan survey. And I just want to know, is that unusual? Am I off base? I mean,
that's unusual.
To have a public forum,
yes,
is unusual.
Right, and I thought that's what the discussion at the beginning of the evening was, that people could come in and provide their input.
No, that's completely different. That's 3 minutes for, you know, just for public comment on whatever is on the agenda or whatever they're thinking about process, like Bernie said. I think for selection and what people expect in a city manager and what their concerns with the city are, obviously, we have a pretty big list here, but really to have a conversation with the public, just what we feel the needs are, what we would like to see, and I have my own opinions. I'm sure everyone has their own opinions, and I'm sure everybody gets they get people talking to them on the side, and that that weighs on what they would decide. But that's also another thing that's very private, and I would like comments about what people want to see as being very open and very public.
Well, again, I must have misinterpreted the initial discussion, because I thought that somebody could come up and give you that input at the beginning of the meeting about what they were seeking in a candidate. The only problem, and public forum is fine if that's what you decide to do. What you tend to do is you get maybe a vocal minority, which may not represent the majority, because the majority usually remains silent and won't show up for those types of things, in my experience. So you are 13 people. We've taken input in other ways from folks. That has come together in an ideal candidate profile and challenge statement. That's
how do you know that those people were the vocal minority?
I'm sure they were.
They came and spoke to you?
I'm sure that a certain group was. Okay. But this is what we do for a living. So we kind of understand who's talking to us and what motivations may be. And I guess I'd say to you, if you read that ideal candidate profile, challenge statement, whether that's accurate. It's not, you can't micromanage, I guess, the traits and qualifications of the individuals, and we can't change the pool of candidates. So the pool is what the pool is. You shop downtown, you're a firefighter, you hang around the fire station, everybody here, if you work, if you're retired, if you belong to the senior group, if you come to the community center, your eyes and ears for the community. So, that probably never stops while you're in this process. Whether you decide to have some kind of a public forum or not, where people can come in and tell you what they want, that's your decision. If you think it's going to inform you beyond what you know as an individual member of the community, what you hear as an individual member of the community, and what you've seen in the documentation that we've given you.
Okay. Thank you.
Is there a downside to doing it? I'm not quite getting that. I mean, I think that the buy-in, and if it's a 1 hour meeting where people just come in and say, but that people have, A, they're acknowledging we're in this process, B, they have a chance to either hear from their friends and neighbors, that we've asked for it. Is there a harm in doing that?
I don't think there's any harm in it. I think it's, you have to be careful what you do with the input that you receive. You could have five people march in here, all for a single cause, with one agenda.
Right.
They tell you all that. Now, those are the only five people who came to the forum. You're going to make a decision based on what those five people told you. They have that single agenda. That's the only issue I see with it.
Right.
So that's why I like to say, when we originally talked about, typically these groups are five or seven is like perfect. Then it was like, okay, nine is tops. Well, 13. That's 13 individual voices that we have here now. With you're surrounded by family, you're surrounded by friends, by coworkers, by people in the community. That's a lot of input almost on a daily basis. So I just don't like to see the process be hijacked by a special interest or by people with agendas. So if you want to listen, I think that's fine. It depends on what you're going to do with that. Because if somebody says, we want A, and that represents a minority, and you end up going to B, then you've upset that group. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of those are the pros and cons of it. I like to, we've always relied on the input that we get, the interviews that we do, and on the individuals that represent the community that are sitting at the interview table.
Quick comment on that. We're an outgrowth of the council, providing the citizens the opportunity to be involved so that these 13 are involved. Because ultimately, it's the council's process, right? And the council, in theory, has vetted all of us. So I understand the idea that other people may want to comment on it, but I think as far as the process works, we've been approved by the council. And as you say, another group coming in could be speaking about only one issue. And they wouldn't be subject to any vetting or anyone on the council saying, you know, I don't think that person's appropriate to provide their personal opinion on these things. So.
Really?
Yeah.
Even they're a resident, a taxpayer, but they should be vetted by the council? I don't think that that's really what I would
think. Then why do we have to be vetted by the council?
I didn't know we were. I thought that they had just asked for volunteers.
They decided whether or not to accept 13 or whether to cut it to 9. I mean, they decide based on what they read of our applications.
Right, but we applied. They didn't just pick us, appoint us. I wasn't asked by anybody to apply.
Mm-hmm.
So I assumed that they chose from those who were interested.
Did. Those were the 13 that were.
So you're saying that if they're not vetted by the council, that they shouldn't have input into who's going to be the city manager of the city there?
At this point in the process, yes.
Wow. I would disagree with that wholeheartedly.
I would too.
Well, I'm wondering how we're going to get off the square for all this. I mean, is there a motion that somebody wants me to make so we can move forward?
Yes.
I agree with Bethany. I just think that this is, and I said this from the beginning, this is such a crucial decision for our community. And yes, we're 13 people sitting up here as a cross section of the community, but there are many more people out there that pay taxes that might want to have say. I mean, we've had many issues that we've dealt with over the past few years. The charter change was one that I know was so much discussion. And we need to have discussion from everybody that we can possibly get to make a good decision. And we may all have our own agendas up here. We all think we know what's best for the city based on our experiences, but that's our personal experiences. This is a citywide decision that's going to affect every taxpayer in Claremont going forward for a decade, probably, if we make a good choice. I see no harm in getting as much input as we can. And there's a buy-in when you try to get as much input from the public and they feel like they have a real voice and there's not just a bunch of talking heads behind a table that makes a decision, then there's going to be more buy-in going forward in that decision. And I really think that's critical for us. So I think a public forum is perfectly appropriate. We may not get anybody that shows up, but we may. And I think we really have to try.
We've had opportunity to speak to Alan.
One-on-one, in private, with no public hearing what people are saying.
Right.
And there were 7 members of the public, according to the mayor, that partook of that. So I don't think that was a big outreach. When you try to do these public forums, you need to do a lot of outreach to get people to come and participate. And we may not be successful in that, but I think we need to try. And I don't think 7 people that showed up should be creating a candidate profile for the city manager. And that's their starting point. That was developed according to the mayor with input from those 7 public members that showed up to speak to Mr. Gould, and he spoke to city staff people in the city council. But again, that wasn't the general public at all being involved.
So as I had said at the last meeting, I would propose that I'm in agreement with public input. I think it's important. I think I can only speak to this community. This is a community I've known for many decades. It's hard to get public input, but when we, as a community, make a topic of conversation and get ourselves out there and make sure that people realize it's important, as we did with the vote we just had about what kind of management we wanted in our community, or if there's that's when people come out. But I'm going to suggest that that if we've come forward, the 13 of us, to say that we'd like to be a part of deciding what the candidates should be for the city manager, then I myself, I for one, am willing to step and take another step and put some time into getting people to realize, stop what they're doing and say, hello, this is an important piece for our community, and would you like to have the opportunity to come in and make a comment? I myself have run into 5 people pretty quickly that didn't realize that there was opportunity to make comment. That doesn't mean that Mr. Gould did not make a good faith effort to get out there and into the community, but he's not part of the community. We 13 people connect to a lot of people. So I'm proposing that we consider that we each individually make an effort to get out and make sure that the public realizes that this is actually happening, that they have an opportunity to make a comment, and that it will be public, and we can all decide as the comments come in whether they're, we ended up with a bunch of anarchy people coming in, or do we actually have actual citizens that came in that wanted to bother to make a comment?
And what's wrong with anarchy people? And what's wrong with anarchy?
Well, I don't know. Mr. Gould was trying to explain. You could end up with a particularly biased group, but I'm not so sure that's going to happen.
I'm getting a little confused because we've got this public forum idea, and then we've got what we had already discussed and agreed upon, that we'll have this public input portion. So
two different things.
These are two different things, okay. And so are we in a position to, it sounded from what Mr. Gould said, it sounded like we may be in a position to request that the council hold this session. But the public forum was supposed to be for the 3 candidates, right? When it comes down to the 3 candidates?
No.
Okay, this is before we get there.
We don't know if the council's going to do anything like that or not.
Okay, all right, so the public forum we're talking about is just... Okay, all right,
another attempt for this group who's going to be part of making a pretty important decision for this whole community to... Okay. I'm just saying we should be, I'm willing to put some time into saying, hello, people out there, this is going to be happening, let's come, do you want to make a decision? Do you realize how important this is? These are the reasons it's important. And do you want to come and make a comment? And even reach out to major stakeholders, hospitals, the school system, the college system, any other list of 10 stakeholders we'd like to come up with. But I myself am willing to put some time into that effort so that when I finish this process, I feel like I have made a good faith attempt to engage the community, because I'm in agreement with people who have been saying, when this particular community, the city of Claremont, is engaged, that's when we all do a better job. And for the most part, it's not always engaged. And so people say, hello, there's something happening. Because people are bringing their kids to soccer, they're trying to work their 80-hour weeks, they're doing all these things with their lives. Okay. And I'm not sure if you asked 100 people in town that could have some input, if they even realize the process is happening. I'm willing to do that, so. Yes?
Well, I'll raise the same question I raised last time. I think we're at a disadvantage in a sense, because the council decided to create a screening committee, and they voted to create a screening committee without any details about our responsibilities. My take on being a screening committee is that we receive applications that have been reviewed by MRI, and we screen them. I don't see our responsibility at all of going out and trying to provide input from more of the community. It may have been flawed, the process may have been flawed in some way or not advertised properly, but the opportunity to have input is basically gone by, with the exception of our vote tonight. Anyone can come in and make a comment, and I don't see why that isn't sufficient.
I agree. I think that the city council appointed us because we are a good cross-section of the community. And I know a lot of people have talked to me about what they want for a city manager, and most of them say a good one.
Right.
I think I'm a little confused here. Early on in the process, I offered a kind of a compromise that we hold one public forum
And then people wanted to allow the public to come in at every meeting, so I thought we were voting for one or the other and voted for coming in at every meeting.
The comments, the vote.
Now you want to do both.
If I can clarify, my understanding of the comments at the beginnings of meetings were just setting aside an appropriate amount of time for public comment about process or what was happening at that very moment in time about the process. This is a public forum about what people would like for a city manager, and I'm in agreement with you. I think we just have one, you know, don't have to make a big deal about it.
But I offered that, and that was refused.
No, it just wasn't, we didn't get back to that particular mode. That's a different kind of mode than.
Well, somebody made a motion to do it at every meeting, so I thought that we were deciding to do it in one or the other.
Right, yes.
Now I'm hearing you want to do both.
I think on the agenda, it was just adoption of rules pertaining to citizen input at every meeting. It was just a housekeeping thing. If someone shows up and they have a question or comment at the beginning, it wasn't to, I don't think that it was intended to take public input as to the qualities or accomplishments of the candidates or anything like that.
Okay, it was now just, I'm gonna ask another question.
Okay.
Where in the process would you do this public forum? Because we've got Mr. Gould has outlined a schedule here that's pretty tight.
Oh, he's very flexible. You'll see he's very flexible. I would say that the forum is to expand upon what was started with the process already, but in my opinion was way too limited to be effective to get buy-in from the community. I think it was done, but I don't think it reached the number of people it needed to reach. So this forum, I don't envision this forum being the comments at the beginning of each meeting, like Bernie will stand up and ask a few questions. I envision the forum being an expansion of what was already started as far as, and that was started was what built the candidate profile. So I think we need more input for that candidate profile so that when we start sifting through these resumes, these 12, we're going to have a better vision of what the whole community might want than just the narrow ones that we had already, and that's what I think this forum needs to do. And I think we try to squeeze that in before we start looking at the 12. I know our time is short, but I think this is critical, and I don't think that we should try to rush anything and leave out something that I think could be important going forward. And that's being transparent and getting as much community input as we can get.
Yes,
I just wanted to say that I don't disagree with the spirit of the comment about the public forum, but I personally know that I started to get people coming up to me as soon as they saw the list of people who were going to be on this committee. I've mentioned this survey before, and there's 131 total pages that are chock full of comments from the community about what they want to happen in Claremont. They're not going to be able to read these applications, and I think they want us to take a little bit of a personal approach to it. So I personally feel like I'm ready to go on to the next stage. I know that I've been very involved in some of this, so maybe I feel like I've had more public comment, but I definitely agree that each of us are attached to hundreds of people, and that is going to be our biggest connection and our fairest connection to the population of the community. I think we're going to have a more well-balanced idea of what the community wants based on, and we're available. I mean, I'm available if people have comments that they'd like to make.
Who is that? Yes.
Abby Grant, please. Thank you. I tend to agree with you, Madam Co-Chair, that the fact that we are members of the first member of the committee here, we should be out in the public. We are known, hopefully, to the public. If we don't, be known by the public. We have to get out and introduce ourselves, and I have tried to do that. I've let people know that I'm out there, and if they have input to requirements to what they want to see in the way of the city manager, please let me know what they are. And I've gotten very, very little in the way of response. And I feel that's probably going to happen if we have a public forum. I don't know how many people are going to show up for this. So I would say what you're saying, Kyle, Madam Chairman, is the way to go on this thing. get ourselves out there, let people know that we are on the committee, we have a job to do. Please provide us with your input if you have anything you want to add to our deliberations here. I think we should go forward that way.
Mr. Rapp.
I would agree with that. I think we should do that, but I also think that we should have some sort of opportunity, one forum to allow. Maybe nobody will show up. And look, this is Claremont. If we go through this process and something goes wrong with whoever we pick, our reputation is on the line just as much as yours is, okay? We make a bad pick and something goes wrong.
We don't make the pick.
Well, we have to get three candidates to the council. And if we get three candidates that don't pan out one way or another, we're on the line for it. And to say that we don't want to have public input, to at least be able to say, well, we had this public forum, people didn't show, or people showed, and this is what they said. To have something go bad and to have not had any opportunity for that forum is going to look really bad.
I think that we should let the city council do that. Once we get the pick of who we want, then the city council should have a meeting. And then they can say, all right, the city wants this type of a person, and we have them here. We're talking about us having a whole pile of people. And like I said, I've talked to a lot of people, and the only thing I've ever heard them say is, we want somebody that's going to keep the tax down and a good one. I don't think you're going to find anything else different. What could be particular about it?
My only thought about that, though, is that what if the council does that, and what they get for input, sorry, we winnowed them down, we threw them out, those were one of the six we got rid of.
They don't know that.
Well, we would.
I don't know what the harm would be to do this, but I can see plenty of harm for not doing it down the road. I just don't think that we would have any problem or harm to invest a couple of hours listening to the public and giving them that opportunity, and we may gain a lot from that. We may gain nothing, but I see a lot more harm in us saying, no, we're not gonna do that, and letting that opportunity go by the boards when we can make this effort and try to get people in here, and we may end up with some comments that none of us would even have thought of. We're a good cross-section, but there's a lot more people out there than are sitting at this table. So to me, there's very little harm in making this effort and putting this time in. It's a crucial, crucial thing we're doing. So I don't think it would be detrimental to us to do it.
And I'm the one that said it should go out into the outreach. I was meaning to go out into the outreach to bring people in so that someone will come in and we all hear that comment. You get to hear it. Not that I get to hear it, and then I get to interpret to you what I think that person is saying, or the inflection in their voice, or how important that is to them, or how unimportant it is to them. So that's the idea of speaking publicly, is the person gets to come in and we all get to hear the same thing. There's no interpretation. Yes, Bethany?
I would like to make a motion that we hold a public forum as soon as possible, maybe beginning of next week. Invite the people in if they have comments or concerns, they want to express themselves. One meeting, we can take the comment, and we have opened it up to the people. Like Deb, I don't see that there is any harm in doing that, but there is a downside to stifling and suffocating public input.
Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second it.
Discussion.
One more round if we haven't made a point of it. Mm-hmm. I guess it was 14 of us. So. Go ahead.
Comment again is that we were appointed by the city council to screen applicants. We have no authority, I believe, to go out and start creating forums. I don't think we have that authority.
I think we do. I think that a committee, once it is formed by the city council, has the authority to make their own rules and run their own meetings. So I disagree.
And I think this forum is going to give us information to screen better.
But we don't have the authority to have.
You're making that assumption.
We do.
I don't know, but based on what.
Same as your assumption that we do have it.
Okay.
So we need to go back to the city council and ask them what they intended.
I think we're on crunch for time here, so.
No, I'm pretty clear that as a chairman, I investigated what it is that we do. And I actually listened to the city council meeting in which the mayor and the city solicitor had a long discussion about what was the role of committees in the city of Claremont and what was the authority of the city council over committees. And the authority of the city council is to create a committee and to appoint and approve the attendees. And then after that, it's the committee itself that is in charge of its rules and what happens. We could go so far as to make our own bylaws, but we're not that complicated. But the chair of the chair or co-chairs of the committee are in charge of running the meetings, and then the committee can choose what they would like to do. We're not doing anything that's illegal or in any way inappropriate. So that, but I'm positive of that, 100%. Yes.
I have just two very brief points. I don't think that a forum next week would have sufficient notice for it to make a measurable impact in what we're doing. And I don't think that we have the time to do something that is going to prepare us for that, because we're going to very quickly start to lose candidates, and the best candidates are going to be the ones that are first to go. So I really would like to get to those great candidates and at least take a look at everything, and if people are really on the fence about things, then we can have a discussion at that point. But I think it would be great if we encouraged people to come and address us at our next regular meeting.
Yes. Kind of along Melissa's points, that I think the master plan survey that we have is probably going to be the most valuable input that we can have, that we're going to get as a committee. I think it's fine to have a public forum if that's what needs to happen to make the committee feel like we've done everything we could. But honestly, she's right, I don't think we're going to get much of any, especially in what, two business days notice. It's not really going to happen in any real sense. So I think regardless, the master survey is what we need to read that. We need to know what it says, what our community is saying to us through the survey, and definitely make sure that the date that we need to hit for having our meeting to talk about the resumes and everything is not pushed back due to this.
Okay.
I think we can fit this in. I know we're sort of under the gun, but I do think we can fit this in. This isn't that big of a deal. And again, I would agree. I think not doing something would do more harm than doing something and not getting a lot of input. That not doing it is the wrong move, I think. I really do. People would, I think citizens will be kind of annoyed that we voted against this, if that's the way that it goes.
As other people have said, I don't think that we'd get that much participation. I'd be totally against it if it delayed our process. If it could do it the first of the week, I'd be more comfortable, but I still am not comfortable with it. If those of you that are wanting to do this can make it happen early next week.
You hear that?
What? Natives.
You hear the noise?
Out the signal.
Was this a signal from up on high somewhere?
Let's get this meeting over with.
Maybe if we get the quorum on Tuesday and then on Thursday to start reviewing the applications, and then we all do as much outreach between now and Tuesday to get people going. And we put something on What's Up Claremont on Facebook, and we post something on the city website and see where it all falls out. I don't see the harm in that. We can still have our meeting on Thursday if everybody can do it and start reviewing the application.
I will say this, that sounds like a great idea. This is just a technical concept. I know when Bethany surveyed everyone, a Monday night is a good, most participation. So today, Thursday, so not this coming Monday, too quick, but the Monday after that, we could be having our whittling down to 12, and sometime next week we can get
The public,
because we want to have a meeting on a day in which we can all be there, the one that we're trying to whittle down and rank 1 through 12. So Monday is the day. We already put the work in to figure out what day is the best day. So Monday. This Monday's too quick. The next Monday would be the meeting.
What is the public notice requirement?
Yes.
24 hours.
It is 24.
24 hours.
That's all.
I have a big project this week that
and you're defeating
is going to take
the purpose.
Me out of state for a good chunk of between Thursday and Wednesday.
Okay, so we're trying to, so next Wednesday, yeah.
So yeah, Thursday until the following Wednesday. I'll be here that Tuesday, and that's it.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
We have a motion on the table?
Yes.
I move the question.
Okay, you ready?
All right.
To move the question, we have to have a roll call vote to move the question.
Right, and you have to have a two-thirds majority.
There's no discussion, so you immediately, we have a roll call vote to
move. Do you have to have a second?
We do not have to have a
second. Okay.
To move the question, so.
Jeremy Diggs.
Aye.
Don Clark.
No.
You're voting no and move the question?
Oh, you're voting on moving the question.
Yes,
yes. Okay, yes. Okay, I'm sorry.
Marty Davis.
Yes.
Margaret Hurley.
Yes.
Larry Johnson.
Aye.
Don Loach.
Yes.
Deborah Manto, yes. Rob Porter.
Yes.
Brian Rapp.
Yes.
Melissa Richmond, yes. Bethany York, yes. Kyle Messier.
Yes. Okay, now the motion on the floor is, can you read it to us, please?
To hold a public hearing as early as possible, to gain public input, invite people to the meeting, and take citizen comment.
Is it a hearing or a forum?
A forum, I'm sorry.
Okay.
So now the question was moved, so there's no more discussion. Unless you have a question about the motion.
I do. Well, I guess I have a question. There's no, we don't have it. That says as early as possible.
Right, yes. That's the motion. That's
good. Yeah. That's all we can go with. Okay.
We will try and obviously make that as early as possible as we can discuss. Okay. Roll call.
Right. Jeremy Diggs.
Aye.
What was that?
Yes.
Okay. I didn't hear you. Don Clark.
No.
Marty Davis.
No.
Margaret Hurley.
No.
Larry Johnson.
No.
Don Loach.
No.
Deborah Matto, yes. Bob Porter.
No.
Brian Rapp.
Yes.
Melissa Richmond.
No.
Bethany Urich.
Yes.
Kyle Messier.
Yes.
Five yeses. Seven noes. Motion.
That does not meet the two-thirds requirement.
No, the two-thirds is for the moving the question. Vote.
That's just,
that was, the forum is a simple motion.
Yeah, that was the moving the question.
And then the motion failed.
So it's failed.
So you wanted to hear something, you voted in favor?
I voted in favor, yes, okay. But...
your question that we didn't pick a date?
Yeah, I would have preferred to pick an actual date. That made sure that if we don't have a problem moving out with the...
But anyway, the motion will go. Okay, so we are on to...
schedule next meeting.
Can we have a roll call vote again? Not another roll call. The results of the roll call vote.
Oh. There was five people who voted in favor of the motion, seven people who voted against the motion. It was a simple majority.
So the motion failed.
Yeah,
yes.
That's right. Motion failed.
So what are we talking about the meeting for then?
That's what I was wondering.
We're talking about our next meeting to do something with the candidate.
To winnow down to the six.
Oh, I thought that was already set for next Thursday night.
No, it's Monday the 31st.
Actually, I don't think we've set.
We haven't. We've been bantering around dates. It hasn't been set. That's what we're
doing. We haven't set a date yet.
Well, Mr. Gould suggested this next Thursday night. That's the assumption that I've been going on.
We want to make sure as many of us can attend.
I will be away Thursday, Friday, Saturday, so that not me. Wednesday's all right.
I'm okay Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Preferably Monday or Wednesday.
Next week?
The 24th and 26th.
Which is next week?
Yeah.
Maybe we ought to start by finding out what dates are available for Mr. Gould.
26th and 27th to clear.
Those are
Wednesday and Thursday.
Next week.
Next week, yes. I'd like to, I think we should pursue, see if Wednesday the 26th.
I would look for that too.
You'll be here then?
I'd probably actually here then.
26th.
Wednesday the 26th. Works for Mr. Gould.
I mean.
Is there anyone in here that it doesn't work for?
It doesn't work for me at an early time. I cannot get here until 6:30. Then I can be here at 6:30.
Can you take a nap, Don?
I frequently do.
You asking me? I frequently do.
So what about Wednesday the 26th at 6:30?
Yep.
6:30? Okay, that's fine.
So that will be like in 5 days from now?
No. And will we do the 12th and will it to 6? At that meeting?
Right.
You know, that should give us time to review.
And so 5 days is okay for everybody to get that done?
I think that's good. I'm happy with that.
Various work schedules and traveling.
It's got a real game in there.
Yeah, no, I'm just making sure.
Location to be determined?
Location to be determined.
Got a comment on that, but I do like this configuration, or maybe a little rounder. I like this location rather than the chambers.
I agree.
It's harder to hear everyone and we're sitting above everyone. I think this is a much better layout, so I would prefer this venue.
I agree. And I also agree that to make it a little more round so that we're able to see each other better.
Sure. Then those who want to show up at 6:00 and make these tables get in a round circle, go right ahead.
I'll do it.
That's my chairman's comment.
We on?
Spoken like a good coach.
I'll be here if you are.
I make a motion, we adjourn.
Second.
Well, that's what I was going to say, we on.
Encouraging everyone to go out and get their comments from their people so that.
You're accurate. I mean, I'm my.